copyrighted program created by the Rio Grande Oil Company.
Long Beach Police calling all cars. Attention all cars to broadcast 68. The bank holdup. Suspect age is 42. Height 6 feet. Weight 200 pounds. Red hair. Light accent. This man is armed. Watch your step, boys. That is all.
I would like to read a telegram just received from the head of the Rio Grande Gasoline Refinery. He says, we technical men at the refinery appreciate your truthful advertising of Rio Grande cracked gasoline. We are glad to testify that gasoline made by the Sinclair cracking process will more than live up to any claims you make in advertising. Signed, William Murray, Superintendent of Rio Grande Cracking Plant, Vinvale, California.
Well, the only claim I've ever heard Rio Grande make is that cracked gasoline is used in more police cars and emergency equipment wherever it's sold than any other brand.
That claim is absolutely true. And where in the world could you find a better test for your gasoline? Police cars meet the same daily driving conditions that you do, and meet emergencies besides. So the gasoline that performs best in police cars is obviously the best buy for motorists.
Sure, but I should think that cities would specify a higher quality gasoline than service stations sell.
That's true. Cities do have rigid specifications for the gasoline that's used in their police cars. Many gasolines don't equal these specifications. But Rio Grande Cracked exceeds every specification. It's better than the law requires. That's why so many cities have selected Rio Grande above all others to power their finest, costliest cars.
Well, that sounds like it might be too expensive for my car.
It doesn't cost you 1 cent more to buy the same Rio Grande cracked gasoline that is specified by so many cities. Every time you fill up from a Rio Grande cracked gasoline pump, you get exactly the same gasoline that police cars use. And you get a better gasoline than you pay for, because Rio Grande's patented cracking process adds qualities you can't get in any other gasoline. And now it is our pleasure to introduce Detective Sergeant A.H. Wambacher of the Long Beach Police Department. Sergeant Wambacher.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It is a pleasure to appear on this great radio program, which for the past year and a half has done so much to acquaint the citizens of the West with the problems and accomplishments of their police officers. Our story tonight concerns the activities of a daring daylight bank robber whose depredations extended up and down the Pacific coast from Mexico to Canada. He was a difficult man with whom to deal, educated, cultured, intelligent. He was a greater problem than the ordinary gutter type of crook. So suave and smooth was his manner that he managed to keep his innocent bride in complete ignorance of the real source of his income. But in the end, he, like every lawbreaker, found that crime does not pay.
You're late.
I'm sorry, Tanya, but I was delayed.
Delayed from seeing me? And you say you love me.
Oh, I do. I was delayed getting you something. Here.
Oh, a lovely diamond ring. For me?
Yes, Tanishka. For you. If you will accept it as an engagement ring.
Oh, it is beautiful. Oh, you are so good to me.
I love you. I cannot tell you in words. I brought my violin with me. Maybe it will speak for me.
Oh, do play it, Grishenka.
I will play you a song of our old Russia. Ochichornia. Why, it might have been written for your smoldering black eyes.
Beautiful. Yusuf.
Does it tell you how I feel, how much I love you?
Yes, Grisha.
Oh, Daniska, will you marry me?
So Grigor, Domshinsky, and Tanya are married. For several months, they live luxuriously, stopping at the best hotels, spending much of their time at resorts up and down the California coast. Then one evening, they are seated in the dining room at Agua Caliente.
You're enjoying yourself, Tanishka.
Oh, it has been wonderful. The last 5 months have been the happiest in my life. After all, I suffered during the days of the revolution. I never hoped to be so happy.
That's fine. I'm glad. Waiter.
Si, senor.
Bring us another bottle of champagne. Cordon Rouge 26.
Si, senor.
It'll be our last bottle of champagne, my Tanishka.
Our last? Why?
We must leave here tomorrow.
Where will we go then?
I don't know.
Oh, I would like to go back to Santa Barbara. We had so much fun there.
No, Tanishka. The fun is over for a while.
What do you mean?
We have only $20 left. You did not think, Tanishka, that this money lasts forever, did you?
I did not. I did not think.
Well, don't worry. We'll have some more soon.
Where will you get it?
I have made a connection.
A connection? Are you going into business?
Well, not exactly. I have a friend who is a bootlegger.
A bootlegger? But, Grigori, that is against the law.
That is a foolish law. The people of this country do not want it. They want liquor. There is money in selling it to them.
Yes, but...
What difference does it make to you, my Tanyushinka? As long as I can get you pretty things and take you a nice place.
But you might be arrested. They might send you to prison.
Oh, no. You can always get out of trouble, even if you are arrested for bootlegging. But there's little worry of that. My friend is very powerful.
But, Grigori, I don't like
now, don't worry yourself about it at all. I'll get the money, and all you have to do, Tanishka, is to spend it.
It is mid-morning a few days later. There are only a couple of customers in a small branch bank in Long Beach when a burly man enters and, standing by the door, pulls out a big automatic.
Take him off. Quiet. Well, this is a holdup, and I want you all to be quiet. The first person who lets a peep out of him is going on a one-way ride to the cemetery.
Don't you please.
You heard me. Be quiet. Now, all of you get in that cage there. Come on, come on, come on. Make it snappy. Better. Now, all of you lie down on the floor. That's all right. You don't have to hold your breath. But don't make any noise. You in the gray suit. Come here.
What do you want?
Come here. Now close that cage door. Now, get to work on this combination.
But I...
Come on, come on. I know you know it. I've seen you work it a couple of times. Now open it up. Come on, snap into it. What's the matter? You're losing your nerve? Here's a nice fat cigar. Puff on that. Blow some smoke into you. Get your nerve up or I'll blow some smoke through you. Yeah, that's more like. Now get back there in that cage. Get down on the floor and stay there. And remember, while I'm emptying the safe, I've got my gun right on you. Dienge, come starina. This, my Tanishka, will buy you a new fur coat. This a new car. Just like the old. Dienge, that's what we need to live. This? Ah, there. Looks like I've got everything.
Now listen. Don't try calling for help for 5 minutes. It won't do you any good anyway. They'll never take me alive.
A few moments later, Grigor Domshinsky joins his wife in a nearby rooming house.
Well, Tanishka, be rich again.
Rich?
Yes, rich. Here is the money, thousands of dollars.
Where did you get it?
From my friend, the bootlegger.
What did you have to do for this?
Oh, nothing much. I just drove a truck up to Los Angeles for him.
But it doesn't seem possible.
There's money in bootlegging, my Tanishka.
Grisha, your hair's red around the edges. Why is that?
Oh, that? I just dyed it that way so it would look as though I was a redhead when I had my hat on. Now, look. See?
Why must you do that?
So no one will recognize me again. Now I must use these clippers and cut off the red hair. And here, here, over here, and more. There. Now see? And I'm blonde again.
Is there that much danger?
No, but one must be careful.
Oh, I wish you wouldn't.
Oh, don't worry. I won't do it again. With this money, we can set up a little shop.
Oh, I would like that.
Sure. And then we won't have anything to worry about. Now listen, Tanishka. I want you to put this money in the shoebox here and take it over to the hotel in Redondo Beach. Leave it in the cupboard in our room.
But why?
Because I don't want anyone to see me. I'm going up to Rudolph's in Huntington Park. After you come back from Redondo, check out of this room and bring your bags to Rudolph's.
Well, it sounds all very strange.
Don't question me, Tanya.
And think of this, my dear. In a couple of weeks, we'll be in San Francisco and we'll have our own place. Now do as I say.
Very well, Grishenka. Listen, the siren. I wonder what's the matter.
Oh, probably the police are going up to that bank down at the corner.
Why? What's happened?
Oh, I don't know. There were a bunch of people around there when I came in. Another holdup, I suppose.
While Domshinsky busies himself clipping his shaggy, dyed locks, Sergeant Joe McClellan has arrived at the bank and is questioning the frightened employees.
Now, what does this man look like?
Only 7 feet tall.
He's
right
here.
He wears a black jacket.
Wait a minute, wait a minute. Not all at once. You, ma'am, can you describe this man?
Yes. He was a big fella, and I was just standing at Mr. Martin's window getting some shopping money. They're running a sale down at the market.
Yes, yes. My wife told me all about that this morning. Now, what did the man look like?
Oh, yes, of course, sir. He was a big man, as I said.
Yes, I heard you.
And he had red hair. And he said that the police would never get him alive.
Big man, red hair, said the police would never get him alive, huh? I think I know this fella. Now, let me get a look at that safe. Say, who smoked this cigar?
I did. He stuck it in my mouth.
Who stuck it in your mouth?
Oh, the robber. He told me to smoke it and got up my nerves to open the safe.
And you smoked it?
Yes, and then after I opened the safe, he pushed me back into the cage. I guess the cigar fell out of my mouth.
He gave you this cigar?
Yeah, stuck in my mouth.
Hermosa Flora.
What are you wrapping that dirty thing up for, Sergeant?
You never can tell what might be important, ma'am. There aren't any fingerprints here.
No. He wore gloves.
Sure, but he got smart once too often. The lone wolf has left a clue.
Yeah, but there are probably 1,000 men in Long Beach who smoke the same kind of cigars.
Sure, but you never can tell. This cigar butt might lead me to the right one.
Back in headquarters, McClellan checked up with Detective E.L. Woodruff.
Well, Joe, what did you discover?
Well, we stopped every highway and streetcar line out of town, Woody. I'm convinced he didn't get out of Long Beach.
Well, I know who he is.
You do?
Yep. He's the guy we call the Lone Wolf.
The Lone Wolf?
Sure. That bird that's been holding up all these banks. The guy that always boasts he won't be taken alive.
Sure, I remember the guy. Described as a big guy with red hair.
Yeah, that's the one.
A neat stroke if we could knock him over. He's wanted all up and down the coast.
Yeah, I know he is. I got a hunch about him.
Yeah, what's that?
Well, you've bottled up the highways and the streetcar lines out of town. He hasn't left, has he?
No, sure of that.
Okay, then he's still in town.
Yeah, but where?
That's where my hunch comes in. I think he's hiding in some rooming house right near the bank.
Why?
Oh, I don't know why, but that's the way I feel about it. You want to look over the neighborhood with me?
Sure. Come on.
Well, this street's as good as any to start on. The bank's there on the corner. Now, this first house here has rooms for rent sign in the window. I'll go in there, Woody, and you start on the other side of the street. If either of us gets a bite, we'll let the other one know. Okay?
Okay.
Good luck.
Same to you.
What is it?
You rent rooms?
Yes, I have one for rent.
Does a big man with red hair room with you?
No. Why?
Well, do you know of a big man with red hair in the neighborhood?
No, I'm sorry, I don't. Why do you ask?
He's a friend of mine.
Well, he's not here.
Thank you very much.
Yes?
You a roomer who speaks an accent and has red hair?
Say, I'm 100% American. I wouldn't rent a room to no foreigner.
Good morning, little girl.
My mama says he doesn't want any.
Tell your mother I'd like to speak to
her. My mama says she doesn't want any.
But I want to talk.
Slam the door in his face, darling.
Oh, good morning, sir.
Huh? Huh?
Have you you got a boarder here who has red hair, a pretty big man?
Huh?
I said, have you a boarder with red hair?
You guessed it. I can't hear so good.
Oh, no. I'm looking for a man, a big man.
Oh, the biggest pan we got is a dish pan. Yeah. What do you want with it?
No, you don't understand.
I better let him go, Mac. I can hear you all the way across the street.
Okay. So long, Pop.
Where are you going, son? I'll let you look at that dish pan.
Oh, nuts.
Oh, all right.
Well, Woody, any luck?
No, not a thing. How about you?
Nothing at all. Maybe my hunch is wrong. We've covered four square blocks and haven't found a thing. I guess. Hey, Woody.
What?
See that pair of legs crossing that yard over there? Under those clothes on the line?
Yeah, what about it, aside from the fact that they're attractive?
Did you stop at that house?
No. No signs or anything to indicate they took roomers.
Well, there she goes down the street, carrying a suitcase.
Well, there's no law against that.
My hunch is working again, Woody. I want to see what's in that bag.
You've got no right to search your bag. That'll be exceeding your authority.
I'll take a chance on that. Come on. Just a minute, ma'am.
What is it?
We're police officers.
Oh, I see.
We're making a little investigation in the neighborhood, and I'm afraid I'll have to ask you to open your bag for me.
Is that something like customs inspection?
Yeah, something like it.
Very well. Here's the key to it for the bag.
Oh, thanks. Leaving town, were you?
No. Just going to visit some friends.
Magazine, perfume, stockings. Hey, Woody, look here.
What?
A box of cigars. Hermosa Flores, the same kind he smoked. I'm sorry, ma'am, but you'll have to come to the station with us.
You realize, don't you, Mac, that this woman may sue us for false arrest. We haven't anything on her.
Yeah, I know that, but there's something wrong about this thing. Something screwy. No nice, clean-cut young woman like she seems to be carries a box of big cigars wrapped up in her undies.
Oh, boy, we're taking a chance.
Maybe so, but I'm going to question her as soon as the matron gets through searching her. I grant you that there isn't a thing but the vaguest clue of those cigars linking her to the holdup, but it's worth risking. Oh, come in. Oh, it's you, Mrs. Sullivan. Well, have you searched the prisoner?
Yes, sir.
Did you find anything?
Nothing but this.
Key with a celluloid tag marked 717. Where'd you find this?
In her shoe.
In her shoe? Oh, that's a strange place to carry a key. Where is the woman?
She's outside.
I'll bring her in.
Will you come in, please?
Yeah, won't you sit down?
Thank you.
Now, please understand that we're forced to cause you this annoyance as a matter of investigation of a very important case. No suspicion is directed at you personally, but it'll be necessary for us to ask you a few questions.
By all means. And for my part, I want you to understand that I am for law and order. I don't know what this is all about, but if I can help you in any way, I'll be only too glad to do so.
Well, that's fine. Glad to see you take that attitude. I can assure you, you'll not be detained any longer than is absolutely necessary. Now, what is your name, please?
Mrs. Edith Stanley.
Mrs. Edith Stanley. Oh, you have an accent. Are you a foreigner?
My accent is French.
I see. I'm interested in those cigars in your suitcase, Mrs. Stanley. Who do they belong to?
My husband.
Your husband? Where is he?
Well, I was on my way to meet him in Laguna Beach. We were going to spend a weekend there. He asked me to bring him some cigars.
What is your husband's business?
He's a manufacturer.
Well, where is his factory located?
In St. Louis. We're out here for a little trip.
I see. And this key with a celluloid tag bearing the number 717. What's that?
I'd rather not say.
I'll have to demand an answer, Mrs. Stanley. The matron found this key in your shoe. That, you must admit, placed a certain suspicion upon it. You were hiding it for some reason. Now, what was that reason?
May I count upon your honor as an officer and a gentleman?
Naturally.
You will keep this confidential.
As far as duty permits.
As you can see, I have no connection with any investigation you are making. And this key, it's a personal matter, a very personal matter.
Nevertheless, I must insist you tell me what this key opens.
It is the key to the apartment of a friend of my husband, who has become a very good friend of mine. I couldn't help it. It just happened. If my husband were to know, it would make him terribly jealous. He might do anything to me and to this friend of ours.
I see. Well, Mrs. Stanley, that's your problem, not ours. And certainly we haven't the time to interfere in your domestic problems.
Oh, thank you.
I trust you'll forgive our detaining you.
Of course. I may go, then.
Very shortly. The matron will make you comfortable.
But why?
Just a routine matter of checking up on your identity.
Oh.
Take Mrs. Stanley away, Mrs. Sullivan.
Oh, but...
And treat her with every consideration.
Yes, sir?
But you said...
It'll only be a matter of a couple of hours, Mrs. Stanley.
Oh, but you mustn't. You can't.
Come along, ma'am, and quietly, please.
Hey, are you crazy, Mac? She told a plausible story.
Too plausible. I'm going to check up on it.
That's risky, Mac.
Everything else she told me may have been the truth, but she lied once.
And when was that?
When she said she was French. Her accent is Russian.
That doesn't prove anything.
Maybe not. But our big man with the red hair had an accent, and he smoked Hermosa Flora cigars. This woman has an accent, and she carried a box of Hermosa Flora cigars in her bag and a key in her shoe. Come on, Woody.
Well, what are we going to do now?
We're going to try to find the hotel this key belongs to.
You may spend a couple of years trying to do that.
Okay, but partner, there's something smelly in this case besides the brand of cigars. Come on.
At rooming houses, at small hotels, at large hotels, at locksmiths and hardware stores, the two detectives inquire for information regarding the mysterious key. The day slowly passes in futile, fruitless searching. And then, early in the evening, discouraged, they enter a small hotel on the pike.
Yes, sir, gentlemen. Like a nice room looking out over the ocean?
No, not tonight. We're from headquarters.
Oh, I see. What can I do for you?
Do you use a key like this here?
No. No, our keys have metal tags on them like this, see?
Oh, have you any idea where this key might come from?
Let me look at it. Oh, sure, I know where it's from.
You do? Where?
Well, the beach house at Redondo. I worked there last summer. That's one of their keys.
The beach house at Redondo, huh? Okay, buddy, thanks. Come on, Woody.
Accelerator to the floor, siren open wide. McClellan and Woodruff streak northward to Redondo Beach. At the beach house, they interview the manager.
Is this one of your keys?
Yeah, why?
Who's it belong to?
What do you want to know for? Who are you?
McClellan of the Long Beach Police Department.
Well, you must be on the wrong track. Folks who occupy that room aren't the kind of people police are looking for.
Well, who does occupy the room?
Man and his wife with the name of Domchinsky.
Domchinsky, huh? Russian?
Might be, I guess.
Do they have an accent?
Yeah, I think they do.
You see, Woody, it all fits.
Yeah, so far.
Why, they're fine people. The man's a musician. Plays a violin. They're out here from New York on the vacation.
The story changes. They're from New York this time, Woody. Are these people in?
I don't know.
Ring their room. If they answer, give them some alibi. Say you made a mistake or something.
But look here, these folks are on the level.
Ring their room. We haven't any time to wait.
Very well. No answer.
We'll go up.
Now look here, I object to my guests being annoyed.
Now listen, you've been in this game long enough to know better than to interfere with a police investigation. Now you sit tight, and if these people come in, you ring us and let us know.
Very well.
Is the elevator running?
Yeah.
Well, looks pretty good, Woody.
Yeah, but I'm not convinced yet. I don't believe in circumstantial evidence. It hangs too many innocent people.
Now, hold your horses, partner. You can never tell what sort of evidence we might turn up. Well, here we are. Now, where's 717?
Right here, across the hall.
Fine. Hear anything?
No.
Get your gun out and let's go visiting then.
Right.
I open the door, you cover the room, and I'll snap on the light.
Right.
Nobody home. Now let's take a look around.
There's nothing in this drawer but some playing cards. Here's a violin case on the table.
Open it up. Anything in it?
Nothing but a violin. What'd you expect to find, a harp?
Hey, what's the big idea?
I just seen if I could play it. Guess these things aren't strung like ukulele.
I wouldn't know. Hey, take a look in that closet, will you?
Yeah. A lot of clothes, a couple of pair of shoes.
Hey, what's this on the shelf?
It's like a hat box to me.
Oh, be still, my quivering hunch. Hey, can you reach it, Woody?
No. You're a little taller. You try it.
Yeah, it's a mighty high closet. You got to stretch up here.
Hey, look out, Mac. It's falling.
Well, Woody, what do you think of my hunch now?
I guess you were right. Looks as though this was the entire haul from the bank.
Yeah, let's count it. Here's 500.
Yeah, here's three packages of $1,000 apiece.
The bank's wrapper's still on them. Well, let's see. And four more. And 15, 20, 22,
22,500,
23.
Yeah, here's $6,000 more.
That's it. Every penny of it. $29,000.
Yeah, but we haven't got the lone wolf yet.
If our luck lasts, we will. Let's go.
We need now is a stakeout on this spot.
Yeah, the boys here in Redondo Beach will help us on that. You got that dough?
Right here under my arm.
Well, now maybe this wise guy will believe us.
Well,
boys. Any luck?
Yeah, $29,000 worth.
What?
Yeah, stolen from a Long Beach bank today.
Yeah, stick it in your safe.
Why, I can't understand. Why Mr. Domzinski seemed to be such a...
Yeah, friend. I know. They usually do. Any mail in his box?
Yeah, a letter came for him today.
Yeah, let me see it.
There you are.
Grigor Domzinski. Been sent to an address in Huntington Park and forwarded here.
Anything important, Mac?
No, but apparently our man's a good friend of the people in Huntington Park. This bird that's writing the letter sends best regards to Rudolph and his family.
Yeah, our next call's in Huntington Park, then.
Right.
Yeah, what do you want me to do with this money?
Keep it in your safe. We'll be back for it. And if Domzinski comes in, don't say anything about us being here. In a few minutes, some officers will be here to wait for him.
Very well. But I can't believe such a fine man would do such an awful thing.
Again, the two officers scream through the night in their high-powered police car. And as they decimate the distance separating Redondo Beach and Huntington Park, Chief Yancey of Long Beach and the shotgun squad, warned by McClellan, is also heading for the Huntington Park address. It is close to midnight when the two officers quietly approach the house. An old man is seated reading in the front room. McClellan taps gently at the door, fearing to sound a general alarm by ringing the bell. A moment later, the old man answers the door.
Is Mr. Domzinski here?
Why, yeah, but he's asleep.
We're police officers.
Police officers?
While the house is surrounded. Best not make any noise.
But what do the police want with my friend Grigor?
Your friend Grigor is a notorious bank robber.
Oh, there must be some mistake. I'm sure he isn't the man you...
Well, we're positive he is. What room's he in?
Right at the head of the stairs.
Let's go, boys. And be ready for anything. This guy's tough.
Hey, the door's open.
Yeah. There he is. The moon shining right across the bed. Turn on the light. Come on, Domzinski. Wake up. You're under arrest.
Why,
keep your hands away from that pillow. I'll empty the shotgun into you. Step the cuffs on him, Tom.
All right. You got me.
What's he got under the pillow, Woody?
A lead pipe and a 45.
Well, Domzinski, I thought you said we'd never take you alive.
I didn't intend you should. That's all part of the game, I guess. And I was going to go straight. This was going to be my last job.
Don't worry about that, Domzinski. It will be your last job for a long, long time.
Domzinski confessed and pled guilty and was sentenced to serve 40 years in San Quentin Penitentiary. Should he ever be paroled, he faces trial and possible conviction in the state of Washington for a bank holdup in Seattle. His poor misled bride was quickly released from jail, heartbroken and disillusioned at the revelation that her husband was a bank robber. Out of deference to her feelings, wherever she may now be, in tonight's broadcast we have referred to her and her husband by fictitious names. The story you have heard tonight is true. These weekly dramatizations are based upon facts obtained by Rio Grande investigators from confidential police files. Because Rio Grande provides the cracked gasoline which powers police cars in so many large western cities, we are in close touch with police work. Tonight, Rio Grande has entertained you. Tomorrow, Rio Grande will thrill you. Just fill your tank with cracked gasoline, and Rio Grande will give you police car performance in your own car. Long Beach Police calling all cars. Attention all cars. The cancellation of broadcast 68 regarding a bank holdup. The suspect in this case is now in custody. That is all. Your narrator, Frederick Lindsley, bidding you good night for the Rio Grande Oil Company. Calling all cars, a presentation of the Rio Grande Oil Company.
Los Angeles Police calling all cars, attention all cars, broadcast 69. A holdup. Suspect described as 5 feet 10 or 11 inches. Weight about 190 pounds. Escape in a maroon colored coupe. License number unknown. This suspect held up and robbed Mae West, motion picture actress, of more than $15,000, the jewelry and cash. Go get him, boy. That's all. Rosenquist.
Many listeners tonight have already read the story of the Mae West diamond robbery in the March issue of Calling All Cars News. Over 300,000 motorists have already driven into Rio Grande service stations and asked for their free copy of this unique publication. But this isn't the only free gift you get from Rio Grande. If you fill up with Rio Grande cracked gasoline, you get extra speed, extra power, extra energy for emergencies, extra fast starting. And all these extras are free because you pay no more for Rio Grande cracked gasoline with tetraethyl than for uncracked gasolines which lack these extra features. Because of these extra features at no extra cost, the police department which solved the Mae West robbery has specified Rio Grande cracked gasoline for all police cars for 3 consecutive years. You get another free gift if you ask your Rio Grande service station for Sinclair Opaline Motor Oil. It comes in oversized cans, a quart for a quarter, with 2 extra ounces free. You save when you buy Sinclair Opaline, yet you get complete motor protection. Sinclair Opaline Motor Oil enjoys a worldwide sale and is world famous for quality. The price is lower because the sales are larger. You see, the independent service station selling Rio Grande cracked gasoline and Sinclair Opaline Motor Oil are actually giving you better values for your money. During 1935, it will be the policy of Calling All Cars to bring you from time to time rebroadcasts of outstanding cases we have dramatized in the past. Thousands of you have written us and expressed your desire to hear the Mae West jewel robbery dramatized again. So it is with pleasure that Calling All Cars tonight brings you the Mae West jewel robbery, with Miss Martha Wentworth playing her now famous impersonation of Miss West. What other past cases of Calling All Cars would you like to hear again? Write to Calling All Cars, care of the station to which you are now listening, and tell us what preceding case you would like to hear. And now we turn the microphone over to Chief James E. Davis of the Los Angeles Police Department, who has a message for you.
Good evening, friends. When I became chief of police, there were several crimes on the police records which had not, I felt, been investigated to the utmost. To run down these crimes, I selected from the force 3 officers, Detective Lieutenants S.S. Stone, W.M. Robinson, and E.Y. Kinett, and appointed them special investigators working directly under my supervision. Among these unsolved cases was the theft of the Mae West jewels. I assigned Robinson and Stone to work on this case, which was, at that time, more than a year old. Although every peace officer in Los Angeles County had worked diligently on this case, nothing had been discovered of any value. Still, I felt that the case could be solved. The quickness and dispatch with which Lieutenants Robinson and Stone brought the case to a successful close speaks more volumes than any words I could utter in praise of them. Tonight's dramatization is based completely on the confidential reports of the investigating officers and the court transcript of the trial of David Friedman. It has also been read and approved by the plaintiff, Miss Mae West. I turn now to Frederick Lindsley, who will tell you of the Mae West jewel robbery.
In the latter part of September 1932, Mae West's automobile is damaged in an accident. She is seriously inconvenienced by the lack of a car, and we find her in her apartment on North Rossmore, talking the situation over with her manager, James Timoney.
Oh, I'll tell you, Jim, it's a nuisance being without a car right now with this new pitcher starting.
Well, you can rent a car.
Yeah, and put your life in the hands of any palooka they send along to drive it.
They could use cabs.
Oh, it's just as bad. And anyway, there's never a cab around the studio when you want one. See who it is, will you, Jim?
Sure. Hello, Miss West's apartment. Who? Just a minute, I'll see. There's a Mr. Brennan in the lobby. You in?
Oh, that's Dave. Sure, tell him to come up.
Send him up, please. Hey, where's this guy?
Oh, you heard me speak of Dave Brennan? His wife and I were good friends in the big town.
Oh, yeah. Seems to me I do remember the name.
Well, he looked me up at the studio today. Just driven in town. I told him to come up and see me sometime. Well, Revolver, what's the matter with you? Hey, Jim, this monkey looks hungry. Did you feed him?
Yeah, right on the stroke of 7.
Oh, okay. What is it, fellow? What are you trying to tell me? You know, Jim, the Revolver here, he has more sense than any man I've ever met. Except in you, of course.
Well, thanks for the exception. After all, I'm your manager, and that does require some sense.
Yeah, I guess it does. Well, that must be Dave, Jim. I'll let him in. Oh, Dave. Good to see you again.
Good to see you, ma'am.
Well, I didn't have a minute to talk to you this afternoon. Come on in. Well, tell me, how's Marge?
Fine as silk, ma'am. Wants to be remembered to you and everything.
Oh, gee, that's swell. Oh, Dave, this is Jim Timoney, my manager. I don't think you ever met. Jim, this is Dave Brennan.
How do you do?
Hello, Jim. I'm glad to know you.
Well, sit down, Dave. Have a cigarette?
Thanks. Gold tips, huh? Doing all right, ain't you, ma? A little different from the time they closed Pleasure Man over in Jersey, huh?
Oh, well, I wasn't doing so bad then either.
Yeah, you ring the bell every time, ma. Well, tell me, how's every little thing out here in Hollywood?
Oh, it's okay. I can't complain. I mean, I'm walking instead of riding these days.
Yeah, what are you talking about, May? You walking? You turned over in a new leaf?
Oh, don't be funny. Well, that lousy chauffeur of mine wrecked a car the other night, and I fired him. And they're still fixing the car, so I haven't a chauffeur or even a car to put him in.
Gee, that's tough. But say, May, I'd be glad to help you out.
What do you mean?
Well, I'm not doing anything out here, just looking the place over. I'll drive you around.
Oh, no, Dave, I couldn't ask you to do that.
Why not? You're welcome to it.
Well, Jim, that sounds like the answer to a maiden's prayer.
Well, anyway, the answer to a prayer.
Okay, then I'm your new chauffeur.
Well, Dave, I accept with pleasure.
So Dave Brennan, friend, serves as Miss West's chauffeur. In a few days, he is completely familiar with her daily schedule. Then on September 27th, 1932, as he is driving Timoney and her along Wilshire Boulevard...
Dave, stop here a minute, will you?
Where's that, May?
Well, the shop at the next corner. I gotta see about a fitting.
Ah, come on, May. Let her go till later. I got an appointment with that chatter writer at the studio. You have a rehearsal.
Oh, now, Jim, it'll only take a minute.
Yeah, I know your minutes. It's a couple of hours.
Listen, you eggs. I'll give you each a dollar for every minute I'm in here, over 10.
That's a bet. Dave, here's the easiest dough you ever made.
Yeah, if you make it.
Here she comes at last.
Yeah, and look at all the bundles.
Yeah, what did I tell you? Bought the place out.
Oh, there, boys. That wasn't long, was it?
Yeah, not much. Spent 26 minutes in there.
26 minutes? Mm. Why, you're screwed.
No, man, that's right. 26 minutes.
So you owe us each $16.
Well, it was worth it. I found some of the loveliest land.
Never mind what you found, May. Come on, pay off.
Oh, gee, I can't right now.
Why not?
Well, I haven't got the cash.
Ah, go on, you're a piker.
Oh, on the level. I haven't any change.
Woman, I don't trust you. Let's see your purse.
Oh, here you are.
Gee, $3,000 notes and 400.
Nothing smaller, so I can't pay off.
What's the idea? Toting that fortune around with you, May?
I just got it out of the bank. I'm sending it east. You know, my mother.
Yeah, it isn't safe to carry it around like that.
I'm getting the postal order for it this afternoon.
No, you're not. You got rehearsals all afternoon and all day tomorrow, too.
Well, I'll have to carry it with me, then.
Gee, $3,000 and $4 C's.
The next afternoon, Dave Brennan makes a date to meet a friend of his at the corner of 6th and Rampart.
Hello, Dave.
Hello, Ed.
This is a pal of mine. Shake hands with Sammy. He's one of the boys.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. What's on your mind, Dave?
Listen, do you want to make a grand?
What's the job?
Grab Mae West's jewelry and her dough.
Sure, that's worth a grand. How about my pal here?
Oh, I'll cut him in for a grand, too.
Fair enough. How about it, Sammy?
Well, fair enough.
Okay, hop in and I'll take you out to the joint and give you the layout. Well, here we are. There's the apartment house where she lives, see?
Yeah, but it's going to be sort of tough making a getaway from that joint.
Wait a minute. You don't have to knock her over in there. Like I've been telling you, I've been driving her around, see? Now, every night after she leaves the studio, her and Jim Timoney, that's her manager, and me, we all put on the feed bag together, see? And right on the dot of 7, we pull up here and Timoney goes up and feeds Revolver.
What do you mean? He loads his gas?
No. Revolver's the name of her pet monkey.
Oh, I get it.
Now, look here. I drive her up here at 7 sharp. I'll pull up by that fire plug across the street, see? Nobody will be parked by it. There's sure to be a vacant place there.
Yeah, then what?
You guys be parked right here. When you see Timoney get out of the car and go into the apartment house, you move in, see?
Easy.
Get the rocks and the dough and take it on the lamb. I'll meet you at 11 p.m. at the same place as this afternoon.
That night, as is her custom, Miss West returns to her apartment house at 7 o'clock and requests Timoney to feed the monkey. She waits in the car, intending to go on to the fights. She has been chatting with Brennan about 3 minutes when she notices a man, coat collar turned up around his face, hat pulled low, swaggered across the street toward the car.
Say, Dave, I don't like the looks of this guy coming across the street.
Who? Oh, him. Just some drunk, I guess.
Oh, maybe. But what's that he's got in his hand?
I don't know. Looks like a handkerchief.
It's a sticker. Hand over the poke.
What?
I said hand over the poke. Come on, give it to me. Now give me the bracelet. Quit stalling.
Oh, don't get in a hurry.
Take your time, buddy. You'll get it.
Oh, there you are.
Now, that necklace. Come on, make it snappy. Good. Now I'll have those rings.
Well, you haven't overlooked anything, have you?
No, I can't think of anything. Can you? Now listen, Mug. Start this car. Keep on going, and don't look back.
Okay.
Hey, Dave, stop.
He said to keep on going.
I don't care what he said. Stop right here. I'm going to try to get his number.
All right.
A big Mug.
Yeah, he's liable to turn the heat on you, May. He sounded tough to me.
Oh, he's nothing but a hoodlum.
Well, will you see anything?
No, I couldn't get the number. It's a coupe, that's all I made out.
Yeah, what's the matter, May? The idea of standing here in the middle of the street. Anything wrong?
Oh, it's plenty wrong. Some Mug just turned a rod on me and lifted my jewelry and that dough I was carrying.
Well, come on, let's report this to the police right away.
Say, listen, May, I wouldn't do that.
Yeah, why not?
Well, if you get the bulls on this job, you may never see the rocks again. I tell you, these gunmen are tough monkeys.
Well, what did you propose doing?
Now, listen, you leave this thing to me for a few days, will you?
Why, what could you do about it?
Well, I had some connections back east. Might do some good out here. Let me look up some guys, and maybe I can get the stuff back for you.
Well, what do you say, Jim?
If you think you can reclaim the stuff, go to it, Dave.
Later, Dave does reclaim the stuff for himself.
Well, boys, that was one of the neatest jobs I ever saw pulled. Nothing messy, you know. Clean from start to finish.
Thanks, Dave. Here's the stuff.
Let me see. Ah, swell.
Wait a minute. What about our cut?
No, I'll pay you off in a couple of days.
Yeah, well, why not now? You got 3 grand notes there.
Hey, you don't want to try to change a $1,000 bill with every bull in town looking for them the way they may be tomorrow, do you?
Well, no.
Now, I'm trying to stall May from reporting it to the cops, but she might jump out of line. Now, you fellas just leave this all to me, and I'll pay you guys off day after tomorrow.
Okay, Dave. Say, Dave.
What?
Hadn't you better return the ice?
Why?
Look, Dave, those rocks are her business. She looks like a good dame to me. We got a grand apiece of her dough. Ain't that enough?
Yeah, but there might be another 10 grand in sparklers here. Say, you don't expect me to turn that back, do you?
Look, Dave, it's none of my business. I done the job for you, and you're going to pay me off. What you do with the rocks is your own business. But if I was you, I'd turn them back. Geez, the dame's going to make a pitcher soon, and she's going to need him.
Yeah? Well, maybe you're right.
Sure I am, Dave. Give him back to her.
Okay, pal. I will.
The next next morning, Timony and Miss West are discussing the robbery in her apartment when the phone rings.
I'll answer it, May. Hello.
I want to talk to Miss West.
Who's speaking? This is her manager.
Well, you'll do. It's about that holdup last night.
Oh, yeah. Get a load of this, May. Well, what about it?
Well, I just wanted to tell you where you can find the purse.
Fine. Where is it?
Well, you go down Rossmore from the apartment to Rosewood Avenue.
Yeah?
Then you turn to the right.
Yeah?
Well, in the middle of the block is a white garage. And behind the garage is a pile of lumber. And under the lumber, you'll find the purse.
Well, that's fine. Where is this Rosewood Avenue? A stranger here in Los Angeles, you know.
It ain't far from your apartment. Next block, down Rossmore.
What's that? I'm a little deaf.
I said the next block, down Rossmore from your apartment.
Yeah, I see. And you said something about a garage.
Yeah, I said the purse is behind the white garage in the middle of the block, under a pile of lumber there.
Yeah, well, thanks. Who is this speaking?
Say, mug, do you think I'm nuts? I'm doing you a favor as it is, telling you where you can find that purse.
Yeah, I know, but I'd like to... Hello? Hello? He hung up on me. Did you get that, May?
Oh, most of it. What's the idea of all the stupid questions and that crack about being deaf?
I just stalled him so I could remember his voice if I ever got a chance to hear it again.
Oh, smart boy, Jim. You ought to be a cop. You got the figure for it anyway.
That's so.
So they left the purse for me, huh?
Yep.
Oh, I wonder if there's anything in it.
Well, let's take a walk over there and find out.
Miss West and Timony follow Friedman's directions and recover the purse under the lumber pile, but it is empty. 2 weeks pass, and Brennan's daily promises to contact the jewel thieves come to naught. Finally, Miss West, advised by friend New York, contacts Lieutenant F.L. James of the police gangster squad and makes a confidential report of the holdup. James devotes weeks of his time to the case. The sheriff's office and the district attorney's investigators also work on it, but no substantial clue is discovered. Months pass. The May West jewel robbery becomes another unsolved crime. Then, James E. Davis is appointed chief of police. Shortly after taking office, he calls Detective Lieutenant Stone, Robinson, and Kynett into his office for a conference.
Boys, beginning today, you three are to work out of this office as special investigators directly under my supervision. You will be relieved of all routine duties, and I want you to spend all your time on certain cases which haven't been cleared up yet. There are a bunch of robberies that have been hanging fire. For one reason or another, no arrests have been made, and no substantial clues turned up. You know the way I feel about such a state of affairs. I have yet to see the perfect crime. There is no case that can't be solved. It's up to you boys to prove that I'm right. The first case I want you to go to work on is that May West jewel robbery. Go out and get the men that did that job and bring them in here. We'll put them away for a while where they can't bother anyone.
Detective Stone and Robinson study the investigation reports of the officers who had originally worked on the case and then plan their criminological strategy.
Well, it's clear from these reports that only two people knew Miss West was carrying that dough around with her.
Yeah, but remember she says here that she thinks maybe somebody spotted the diamonds at the fight.
Ah, that doesn't mean anything. The first thing the stick-up man said was, hand me the poke. The only thing in the purse he wanted was the money.
Yeah, that's right.
Now, two people knew about that money. Timony and Brennan.
And Timony's out. He's been her manager and trusted friend for years.
Right. So that leaves Brennan, who, after all, was only a casual friend. Let's work on that angle.
Holmes, your deduction is astounding.
Elementary, my dear Watson. Elementary.
Well, all right. Let's get a line on this Brennan guy.
The investigation of Brennan's acquaintances limits itself finally to Edward Friedman as the man most closely resembling the general description of height and weight given in Miss West's report. Friedman, having been booked on a previous charge, the police records include his picture and fingerprints. Stone and Robinson take Miss West, the mug of Freeman, for identification.
Well, is this your man, Miss West?
Oh, let me see now. Sort of dark and handsome, isn't he?
Well, what about it? Is he the guy?
Well, I can't tell for sure. You see, he had his hat pulled down, his coat collar turned up, so his face was pretty well hidden. But if I could hear his voice or see his hands, why, then I'd be sure.
What do you mean, see his hands?
Well, he had short, pudgy hands. That was the one thing about him that impressed me.
Well, we'll run this guy down and let you get a look at his hands.
Stone and Robinson set out to run down Friedman, but they are blocked when they discover that he's out of town. A couple of weeks pass, and then an anonymous telephone call informs them that he's returned. For several days, they cruised the neighborhood of 6th and Dunsmuir, where Friedman lived, without spotting his car. Then, on Thanksgiving Day, accompanied by their wives to avert suspicion, they once more visit the place. This time, they are successful in locating Friedman's coupe, parked on 6th Street. For 2 hours, they wait, parked nearby, and then at last a man comes out of an apartment house and approaches the car. They recognize him from the picture in the mug book as Friedman. As he gets into the coupe, Robinson walks up to the right side, and Stone closes in on the left side of the car.
Open that door.
What's the big idea?
We're from the Detective Bureau. Get out.
What's the rap?
We want you for the May West robbery.
It's a bum beef.
Come on, get out of the car.
I'm coming, you big flat foot.
Oh, no, you don't. You can't. Get away out of there.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. I'll go.
Set the bracelets on him, Bill.
Okay.
All right, let's go.
Robinson take Friedman to the University Police Station, where they question
him. You know Dave Brennan?
No.
We know you do.
Well, so what?
We want that jewelry back.
That lousy jewelry. Brennan promised to return it to May West. If he had, I wouldn't be here now.
What did you get for that job?
All I got was a grand.
And it's hardly worth it, was it, Friedman?
Well, I needed dough. But it was a crying shame to take that dame's rocks.
Well, what are you going to do about it now?
I'll take my rap, and I'll take that double-crossing rat Brennan to the pen with me.
Having obtained Friedman's full confession, Lieutenant Stone calls Miss West and informs her that they have a suspect in custody who has confessed. Miss West asks him to bring the man over to the apartment at once. She and Timoney greet them outside the apartment house.
Miss West, this is Mr. Friedman, the suspect I told you about.
I remember Miss West from the night I held her up.
Oh, yeah. I remember your voice now. This is the man, all right, Lieutenant.
Well, what would you say, Mr. Timoney?
Sounds like him to me, but I'd have to hear his voice on the phone to be sure.
Well, I guess we could arrange that too, Mr. Timoney.
Well, listen, Lieutenant. I'd like to talk to Mr. Friedman alone. Mind if we get into the car? It's kind of cold standing out here.
Sure, go ahead.
Thanks. Well, look here, pal. Just what was the big idea?
Listen, Miss West, I'm sorry about the whole thing. I really am. If I'd known you were so regular, I never would have agreed to do it.
Well, it's all very nice to hear, but how about them diamonds of mine, huh?
I don't know where they are. I got a grand for the job, and I was through. Brennan took the rocks.
Oh, so Brennan was in on it, eh?
Sure.
Oh, that's the limit. And I call that guy a friend. I guess I'm just a chump.
I made Brennan promise to return the diamonds.
Oh, you're good at moving mountains, too.
I wanted to come and tell you about it a lot of times. If I could have gotten the jewels back for you, I would.
You know, you're not a bad guy, Friedman. I don't know, but I feel kind of sorry for you. But that double-crossing Brennan, if I could get my hands on him...
You and me both.
The long arm of the law reaches out for Brennan, and he is arrested in Chicago. Friedman is indicted by the grand jury on December 4th on 2 counts of robbery, the May West job, and a prior holdup. On January 24th, 1934, Friedman goes on trial before Judge Harry Sewell. Day after day, the courtroom is packed as May West gives her testimony. On February 2nd, the jury is given its instructions and retires. At 1 a.m. on February 3rd, the jury files back into the still-crowded courtroom.
The jury's coming back in.
Gentlemen of the jury,
Have you reached a verdict?
We have, Your Honor.
Read the verdict, please.
We, the members of the jury, find the defendant, Edward Friedman, guilty as charged in the indictment of robbery in the second degree.
Stand back there. Get some water, someone.
Oh, what seems to be the matter, Jim?
Friedman's fainted.
Oh, a tough guy, huh? Just a poor hoodlum. He can dish it out, but he can't take it.
Judge Sewell sentenced Friedman for from 2 years to life in San Quentin Penitentiary. He appealed his case, and the appellate court confirmed the judgment. Stubbornly, he carried his fight to the state Supreme Court, but that august body refused to review his case, and Friedman must serve his time. Dave Brennan, instigator of the plot, was arrested in Chicago, jumped a $10,000 bond, and traveled to Miami, Florida, where he was arrested again. Although Captain Stone traveled all the way to Miami to bring back his man, the governor of Florida ruled that as Brennan was under bond in Illinois, he would have to be extradited from that state. So the fight for extradition goes on. We, the police, have performed our duty and discharged our obligation to Miss West and to society in apprehending these criminals. But how quickly they can be locked behind prison bars is a question that can only be answered by those who manipulate the red tape of the law.
Thank you, Chief Davis. Ladies and gentlemen, if you want further information on the May West diamond robbery, you can get the story illustrated in the March issue of the Calling All Cars News. Just drive into any Rio Grande service station and ask for your free copy. You are under no obligation to buy anything. But if you have not yet tried Rio Grande cracked gasoline, we urge you to fill your tank and then hunt for a hill. As soon as Rio Grande cracked reaches your carburetor, you will find your car developing new energy. It will accelerate easier. You will go over hills in seconds where you formerly had to crawl in low gear. You won't have to shift gears so often in traffic. For Rio Grande cracked gasoline with tetraethyl has extra energy, extra speed, extra power, because it's refined by the distinctive cracking process that creates a livelier gasoline. To prove to you that Rio Grande cracked is a better gasoline, we refer you to cities like Oakland, Berkeley, Merced, Los Angeles, and to Maricopa County, Arizona, which have made tests and specify Rio Grande cracked gasoline exclusively for all emergency engines. Wherever it is sold, Rio Grande cracked gasoline powers more police cars, ambulances, fire engines, and other emergency equipment than any other brand.
Los Angeles police calling all cars, attention all cars. Cancellation of broadcast 69 regarding a holdup. Suspect described in this broadcast is now in custody. That's all. Rosenquist.
This is your narrator, Frederick Lindsley, bidding you good night for the Rio Grande Oil Company.
A program created by the Rio Grande Oil Company from confidential police files.
Oakland police calling all cars. Attention all cars. Broadcast 70. Regarding a murder. That's all.
Woman reporting a crazy man at 14th and Pierpont Streets. Hurry.
That's us. Let's go.
Jake want a lot of pep? This old car's got a lot of pep.
Say, it's a different car since we've been using that Rio Grande crack gasoline.
Oh, is the city changed gasoline? I didn't know.
No, you'd know the difference if you were driving police cars regularly. All the drivers are nuts about this new gasoline. It starts so fast. And look how it accelerates. Say, I never got speed like this with the old gasoline.
Well, this hill will slow you up. Are all the Oakland police cars using Rio Grande gasoline now?
Yep. New city orders. All police cars, all fire engines, all emergency equipment. They've all switched to Rio Grande crack. The Berkeley police and fire departments are using Rio Grande, too. You know, it looks like all the cities are using it. I hear that Los Angeles police cars are using it for the third consecutive year now. And no wonder. Look how he breezed up that hill. In high, all the way.
Yeah?
I'd have been in second gear with that old gasoline. Rio Grande sure got the power.
Hey, I can feel the difference. Do you suppose Rio Grande makes a special gasoline for a police car?
Oh, nope. It's the same gasoline you get from their independent dealers. You know, I'm using it now on the family bus. And I'm getting wonderful results. Just drive into any service station that advertises Rio Grande crack gasoline, and you'll get the same gasoline as these police cars are using.
Holy cats, we're here already. All right, slow up. Look out for trouble.
And now we take you to San Francisco, where Chief Bodie Wallman of the Oakland Police Department will speak to you from the studios of KFRC. Chief Wallman.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Those of you who are regular listeners to Calling All Cars must have come to the realization that the average criminal is a pretty sorry fellow. He doesn't win. He never comes out ahead. And for the most part, he doesn't use much originality in the conception and execution of his crimes. In telling the story of crime, the activities of the police are almost always the most interesting. But occasionally there occurs a case where the story of the man involved is the focal point of interest. Such is the story that we have to tell tonight. You will not hear his story reeking with blood and melodrama and complicated with detective work. Instead, we will tell the story of a man endowed with the attribute of greatness, but unable to cope with the bitter realities of life.
Madre de Dios, I cannot make it come out.
Carlos.
You what?
Carlos, I must speak with you.
Did I not tell you not to disturb me? Didn't I tell you to leave me alone?
Yes, Carlos, I'm sorry to interrupt, but the baby has no milk and...
You dare, when I am composing the most difficult passage of my symphony, you dare to bother me about milk.
I'm sorry, Carlos, but we must have money.
Money, money, that is all I hear. Have I not earned money for you?
Yes, Carlos. You have been a good husband. Up until you quit your job 3 months ago.
Oh, you accuse me.
No, Carlos, I don't accuse you.
Your voice, it was accusing. How could I go on in that job any longer? How could I continue to work in that music store, selling pianos to people who will never play them, listen to pigs talk Beethoven, when within me sang a great melody, a great symphony, burning, searing my soul, bursting the bonds of my brain, demanding to be written down that all the world might hear it.
Yes, Carlos, I know all that.
Can I borrow money on my beautiful diamond ring so that you and the child could eat?
Carlos, you did?
Pay those people with all that money.
It is all gone, Carlos. There is no more money.
Then get some more. Go out and walk these streets. Get it any way you like. Do not bother me.
Carlos, you must listen to me. We must have money.
Get out. Get out or I'll kill you with my two bare fists.
Carlos.
You heard me. Do not want to be annoyed. Get out. Get out! Get out!
A few days later, Carlos Madro is walking along a street in Oakland, wrapped in thoughts of his symphony, when he is hailed by a passerby.
Hello, Madro.
Oh, hello. Senor Harris.
Oh, you're just the man I wanted to see. Matter of fact, I've been looking for you for several days.
See?
Yes, regarding that loan I made you. Now, it's a month overdue, and you haven't even paid me the interest on it. Now, I'll have to have that money.
Money, money. Do not talk to me about money.
Well, I know it's a disagreeable subject, Mabro. A root of all evil, as the Bible says. And I dare say the Bible's right, too. But it's what makes the world go round, you know.
That ring I gave you as security. It's worth many times the money you lent me. That ring is worth thousands of dollars.
But I can't tie up my funds with any ring. Now, if you don't pay me cash, why, I'll just have to sell the ring for what I can get out of it.
Sell the ring? No, you would not dare do that.
Why not?
My mother gave me that ring. It was worn by my father when he was at the court of the key in Madrid. It is the last of my father's treasure.
Oh, I can't help that, Madro. I can't let sentiment interfere with business, you know.
The ring, it is valuable to me. I will claim it someday. When my symphony is complete, I will have that money. I will be the most famous musician in the world. Then I will pay you your money twice, three times over.
No, I can't count on promises, Madro, but I tell you what I will do. I'll give you until day after tomorrow. And if you don't pay up then, why, I'll just have to sell the ring.
No, no, you cannot do that.
Oh, yes, I can, and I will.
Very well. I get the money.
Now you're talking.
Come to my house tomorrow afternoon. Bring the ring with you.
That's fine, Madro. I'll be there, say, around 3 o'clock.
See, 3 o'clock. See, 3 o'clock will be as good a time as any.
Go right on the dot of three, as you can see.
I expect you would be on time.
You have the money?
See, come in.
Thank you.
Into my studio here. You have brought the ring?
Right here in the pocket.
I know. Sit down, Senor Harris. Before we conclude our dealings, there is something I want you to hear.
What is it?
Part of my symphony. Do you not think the world will pay to hear that? Do you not think that money will pour in from that? Money to pay you?
Now, look here, Madro. I haven't time to waste. I have other appointments this afternoon. Now, I came here in good faith, and you promised that you would pay me.
I will pay you. But you have not answered my question. What do you think of my symphony?
Well, now, I can't say, Madro. I don't know much about this classical stuff. I lean more to ragtime and Carrie Jacobs Bond songs. You know what I mean. Like the man says, let me write a nation's songs, and I don't care who makes its law.
I do not follow you.
Well, I mean, give the people something they can whistle, something they can dance to.
You do not think the breaking heart of mankind sings in this? You do not think the heavy feet of destiny dance through these measures? Listen.
Can't argue that point with you, Madro. Of course, I don't know much about music, just like I said. You know, I'm just a plain businessman.
Hey, shut up! Listen! Listen to humanity on the rack! Listen to the sanctuary shriek mockery! Listen to mankind revolt! Listen to the awakening of the world! Listen to the crushing of oppression!
Here, Madro, I haven't any more time to waste here. I have a lot of appointments this afternoon. Now this demonstration's gone far enough. If you'll kindly pay me just as you promised, I'll turn over your ring to you and our dealings will be at an end.
Listen, Mr. Harris! Listen to my kind answer!
Now look here, ma'am,
Oh, Senor Harris. Our dealings are at an end.
Hey, pardon, Inspector Wallman, but there's a woman outside. I think you better talk to her.
Well, what's her trouble?
Yeah, she says she's afraid of her husband.
And the world would probably be a better place if more women were the same way. Now, you take care of her, Sergeant. I've got a lot of things on my mind.
Yeah, well, this is important, Inspector. She's afraid her husband's going to kill her.
Well, that's a little different. I suppose the perfect homicide squad should prevent murders as well as solve them, eh? Well, sure, in.
Yes, sir. Will you come in, ma'am?
Thank you.
This gentleman here will take care of you.
Thank you. Are you the chief?
Well, no, not yet, but I have hopes. Well, what can I do for you?
I'm frightened. I'm scared of my husband.
So the sergeant told me. Why are you frightened of your husband?
Well, last week he threatened to kill me when I asked him for money to buy milk for our baby. And today, when I came home, he had his diamond ring back and he tried to get me to go into his studio with him. He said, look, I got it back. Oh, and there's a funny look in his eyes.
Now, wait a minute, wait a minute. What's the diamond ring to do with it?
Well, you see, he borrowed some money on his diamond ring so we could eat. And he didn't have any money to redeem it. I don't know how he got it back.
Well, how do you suppose he obtained it?
Oh, I'm afraid to think. But he threatened to kill me. Maybe he's killed Mr. Harris, the man who lent him the money.
Well, why didn't you ask him where he got the ring?
No, I was afraid. He looked at me so strangely. He kept telling me to come into his studio. And he never lets me in there.
I see. Well, we'll just calm your fears. I think Inspector Kai and I better see you home. Watch this guy, Kyle. He may be a nut.
Yeah.
All right, lead the way, man.
Don't bother me. Keep out. Keep out.
Gentlemen are here. They're looking for Mr. Harris.
Not bother me. I have it. I have it at last. Just listen.
Where's Harris?
I didn't know.
He was here, wasn't he?
Yeah, I think so. Perhaps he was. George, he left out. Do not bother me now.
This guy's clumsy or something, Kyle. Now keep your eye on him. I'm going to take a look in this closet. What's up?
Here's Harris.
You have spoiled it.
Murder.
You have spoiled it. I had the whole thing. The essence of humanity suffering. I had it, I tell you. You spoiled it.
Who killed this man? Who killed this man?
I don't know.
Inspectors Wallman and Kyle take Carlos Fabio to headquarters. For 2 hours, they question him in the presence of Chief of Police Peterson. Never does Mondro deny his guilt, but seems, on the contrary, not to be listening to the questions of the officer. Ceaselessly, he hums his symphony, trying to impress its melody and harmony into his brain, so that later he may write it down. When, apparently for the first time, the officer's questions penetrate his brain, Mondro makes a simple confession, explaining in detail all that occurred. He is held to answer to a charge of murder, and a few months later is sentenced to San Quentin Penitentiary for life by a jury which, unimpressed by his plea of self-defense, has returned a verdict of second-degree murder. Shortly afterwards, he is delivered into the custody of the warden of San Quentin Prison.
Any new arrivals today, McIntosh?
Aye, sir. One.
Where from?
Oakland. Second-degree murder.
Has he been taken care of?
Yes, sir. Mugged, printed, shaved, and outfitted. Waiting outside now if you want to talk to him.
Yes, I'll talk to him. Bring him in.
Aye, sir.
Come in here, 7612.
Aye, you.
My name is Carlos Madro.
Yeah, you're off that when you walk through that gate out there. From now on, you're 7612. You see, the number's printed across your jacket.
See.
The warden wants to see you. Right this way. Ahead of you, sir.
Thanks, Mac. Well, that'll be all for present.
Aye, sir.
Well, you don't look much like a murderer to me.
I am not a murderer. I am a composer.
A composer? Well, that's fine. We'll find you a place in the printing plant.
You do not understand. I do not survive. I write music.
Oh, you write music.
All I want is a chance to finish my symphony.
I see. What is your name?
Madro. Carlos Madro.
Well, look here, Madro. Let's start off right. Let's understand each other, you and I. You'll have to work up here. You're going to start a life that is completely different. You'll have to adjust yourself to a set of circumstances completely different from any you've ever known before. And you won't find many people sympathetic with your desires to finish a symphony.
I'm willing to work, Warden. I suppose I have committed a crime. I'll pay for it. I'll do anything you say. You have shaved my head. You have taken away my name. That is all right. I do not care what you do to me. Just so long as I can go on working. All I want is a piano so I can finish my symphony.
A piano?
See.
Well, Madro, ourselves don't come furnished with piano.
But I must work on my symphony.
Well, we can place you in the prison orchestra. They rehearse once a week.
Once a week? But when can I work on my symphony?
I'm afraid, Madro, that you can't.
Boys, not that way. Now look here. Clarinet, not so loud. You must have learned to play in a beer garden band. String, more smart. Trumpet, you tap into that more tempo. Madro,
what are you playing, please?
Trying to work out some harmony on my symphony.
Your symphony? You're worrying about your symphony when I can't even get these doomheads to play one superi. Now you save your symphony for when you get parole. Now, all together, boys, once more.
You'll get used to it. The juice mill always gets the fresh fish at first. Wait till you've been at it as long as I have.
How long is that?
5 years.
5 years in this terrible place. I cannot wait that long.
Don't you hurry. You're not going anyplace.
5 years, 10 years. A life. No piano. Nothing but scraps of paper and bits of pencil. Nothing to beat our time. Nothing to help me get the notes on paper. Nothing. This machinery, these wheels, these belts, they have rhythm, they have tempo. That is it, that is it. My third movement, my march, the rhythm of the juice.
Ain't seen him. Maybe he's got the pip.
Yeah, that'd be swell. Maybe we wouldn't have to have any practice.
Ah, pipe down, you smugs. Here comes the warden.
Hey, look. It's screwy piano player Madro's with him.
Oh, boy. Our orchestra leader, Dr. Steiner, has been forced to resign because of poor health. Well, I asked him if he could recommend anyone. To my surprise, he said that one of us here was even better qualified than he to lead the orchestra. So upon Dr. Steiner's recommendation, I'm turning the baton over to Carlos Madro, number 7612. He is in complete authority, and I expect you to obey his orders as explicitly as you did Dr. Steiner. That's all.
What you doing? Looking for a parole?
Hey, a red apple and the teacher, eh?
Are you finished now? Thank you for the welcome. I would rather have that than a lot of hypocritical applause. Now that I know what you think of me, I'll tell you what I think of you. I think you are the worst aggregation of so-called musicians I have ever heard in my life. I intend to change all that. I intend to make this a real orchestra. Do not worry, there will be no tales carried to the warden. We will handle this just between ourselves. I will see the job through. I have plenty of time. I am here for life. Now that we understand each other, let's get to work. First violins and basses, with clarinets. Start on high up. Come down to E and D, basses and the bass. D minor chord on second beat, the same. I play that very broad. You ready? Good. Now, once more. More 40 this time.
Hey, what is this, a memory chord? Where's the part for this stuff?
You'll get them soon. I am still writing it.
Under Modro's expert musicianship, the San Quentin Prison Orchestra becomes a really fine musical organization. And its fame spreads all over the country. Slowly, Madro wins the hard-boiled members of his aggregation to a staunch personal loyalty. And many are the fine musicians he develops and sends forth from the grim walls of the old prison.
Slowly, surely, Modro works on his symphony, aided by the bitterly won cooperation of his musicians in helping him solve many intricate problems of scoring. Finally, it's completed, and feverishly, Modro rehearses his men to prepare the composition for its first public playing at the holiday entertainment within the prison walls. At last, the great day arrives. Proudly, the warden announces to the inmates and the guests from the outside that the San Quentin Orchestra is about to play for the first time the Symphony No. 1 of Carlos Modro. Trembling with emotion, Modro takes a stand, raises his baton, crashes into the opening chords of his great work. As the symphony progresses, the jazz-minded convicts squirm in their seats. For the guest of the warden, seated in the front row, listens with keen interest.
Hey, you know, warden, that's great stuff.
Yes, I'm mighty proud of that boy. This part of it he calls the rhythm of the jute mill.
Yeah, the rhythm of the jute mill, eh?
Yeah.
I don't suppose there's any chance of taking this outfit out on a vaudeville tour.
Well, hardly.
Yeah, I didn't think so. Too bad. I could clean up a fortune with him. And a great attraction.
Undoubtedly. But there's hardly any sense in carrying a 40-man crime wave around the country the way things are right now.
Yeah, that thing he's playing is good stuff. Yeah, I could do something with that.
What do you mean?
Well, get it published. But I suppose there'd be an objection to that, too.
No, I don't see why. Madro's done a very nice thing then. If he can realize honest, he's entitled to it. After all, the state saves $1,500 a year by using him as band leader instead of an outsider.
Would there be any chance of me seeing him after the concert?
Certainly. I'll have him sent to the office. You to meet a friend of mine, Mr. Edward Cohn.
Glad to meet you, senor.
Mr. Cohn's in the theatrical business, Modro.
Si. Ah, it's a real pleasure to hear your composition tonight, Modro. I want to congratulate you.
Thank you, senor. I worked a long time on it.
Yeah, you can see that you have. I like particularly the third movement.
The march. I call that the rhythm of the jute mill.
Yeah, so the warden told me.
Did I get the hopeless, the suffering into it, Mr. Cohn?
Yeah, I think you did.
Did you feel what I was driving at? That life is a jute mill? That we are all convicts? Our souls imprisoned within our bodies, given a life term in a floppy prison of flesh. We labor there in that mortal jute hopelessly until death arouses us. That is what I was trying to say in this fourth movement. The freedom, the parole that death brings, the transcending spirit solving all problems in eternal peace.
Yeah, I got all that.
Very good.
Very good indeed. A fine piece of work. Now, what I wanted to ask you, Mother, would you be willing to have this work published?
To have it published? To bring this message to the world? Will you publish it for me? Can you do it for me?
Can and I will.
Oh, wonderful. Warden, this is more than I ever expected. More than I hoped could happen. To be able to bring my message to the world.
We will do that, Mondo, I can assure you. We will make recordings of it so that people can play it in their home.
Recordings of it? Magnifico, magnifico. Be sure to tell whoever makes the records what I have just told you. It's all there. It's all in the music.
Of course it is. Amado, I've done up a little agreement here. If you'll just sign it.
You promise you will publish it and then make recordings of it?
Yes.
I'll sign it. Give it to him. I'll sign it. There is only one thing more, Mr. Cohn.
Yeah, what's that?
Send me the first record they make, will you?
I certainly will. First record will come to you.
Thank you, senor. Thank you very much.
Weeks, happy Carlos Modro walks the prison yard on clouds. His imprisonment means nothing to him now. He tastes the sweet nectar of artistic achievement and already is planning his symphony number two, his next great work. And then one day he receives a summons to the warden's office.
Come in, Modro.
You sent for me, senor?
Yes. The record's come.
Let me hear it.
Right away.
I had my electric phonograph brought over from the house so that you could get every note.
Please turn it on. Turn it on quickly, please.
Very well. Here it is.
That is not my symphony.
Of course it is.
That is not a symphony orchestra. That is a band. Here, let me see that record.
There. Here you are.
San Quentin March. Convict number 7612. My rhythm of the jute mill. Played by a cheap band.
Do you want to hear the rest of it?
Well, thank you.
Well, here's your record.
I do not want it.
Why, what's the matter, Bartle? Where are you going?
I'm going back to the future.
Having saved the state $10,000 by his services as orchestra leader, the man we have called Carlos Madro was finally paroled in 1929, a broken and sick old man to be deported to his native Spain. It is said that through the success of his published music, he realized more than $100,000 during the time he was in prison, and that this sum was held by influential friends who sponsored his parole. But for him, spiritual life ended when his dream of artistic success was shattered. Having suffered one stroke prior to his release from prison, it is doubtful if he is alive today. Calling All Cars is a presentation of the Rio Grande Oil Company, refiners and marketers of Rio Grande cracked gasoline.
Police calling all cars, attention all cars. The cancellation broadcast 70 regarding a murder. Suspect in this case is now in custody. That's all.
Cars is written and produced by William N. Robeson. Original music for tonight's broadcast was composed and arranged by Albert K. Malott. The orchestra was under the direction of Frederick Starr. This is your narrator, Frederick Lindsley, saying good night for the Rio Grande Oil Company.